What does that even mean, Bowers Game Corner?
Ahoy there, YouTube! I'm back again today for another game review, and today I'm very excited to check out The Memory Palace from Peaceable Kingdoms. This is for 2 to 4 players, ages 5 plus. It'll take you about 15 minutes to play, and in The Memory Palace, you are going to be building a palace out of tiles, and then placing down animals, doing silly things in that palace, and trying to remember where you placed the animals and what the animals were doing. This is a young children's game, but is it good? Let's open it up, and I'll tell you what I think about it. Alrighty then, we're going to take a look at what you're going to get inside of Memory Palace. So first and foremost, we got our handy dandy rule booklet. It's really about one page, double-sided, full color, and it's really well done. It should get you up and running in no time at all. That being said, I do not recommend using this rule booklet. I'll tell you more about that, why, and the pros and the cons. So right now I have a 3x3 grid set up, and that's more for camera space. But as you can see, there are many other tiles included in the game. They could leave you enough to set up a 4x4 grid, and I would highly recommend always playing with the 4x4 grid. I don't know why you'd ever make it smaller. And as you can see, bright, colorful, vivid, not double-sided, but yes, there you go. Now, you're also going to get these little circles right here, and these circles are going to have different animals on them. Fish and snails and snakes and silly monkeys and puppies. And one thing I really do enjoy about this is each one has like their own, they have like their own visual flair, like, and it helps make the stories, which I'll tell you about later. But like the tiger, like, he looks angry. The shark looks angry. The skunk looks happy, you know. The porcupine's just like, but you're going to get a whole bunch of these different animals. As you can see, lots left over in the box. Next, you're going to get 3 memory monsters. These are the guys that you do not want to find. So let's go over how the game is played. So when you first start the game, as I mentioned, normally on a 4x4 grid, you're going to randomly put the memory monsters down somewhere around the board like so. Next, you're going to have 8 or 6, or really however many of these animals you want face down. As you get better at the game, you'll probably want to play with more. And you're going to take turns going around the table, and you're going to draw one of these animals. Then you're going to make up a silly story about that said animal and what they're doing in that specific location. So the kids are going to be doing this. So, for instance, I might say, oh, the ant is hanging out by the pool, and what he likes to do is jump out of the tree and scare people off the diving board so that they fall in the water because he's a mean little ant who enjoys doing that sort of thing. So that would be my story, and then I would flip it over. Next, the kid would go, and he would probably say something like, oh yeah, the shark's gonna be, he's on the stairs, and he's gonna bite people when they come up the stairs, because they're his stairs, and so that might be their story. And then we would have, next we'd have the snail, and the snail is gonna be trying to drink the hot cocoa, so he's jumping, boom, bounce, 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 he's trying to jump and drink the hot cocoa, so that might be his thing. But anywho, you're gonna go around the table, and then you're going to place all of the different things around. Normally, as I mentioned, you have a 4x4 grid. So, after everything has been placed and you've listened to all the stories, now you're going to elect one person to be the memory master. The memory master is going to go around the board, and he or she is going to try and flip over something and then say what's happening there. So, for instance, this one, they say, this is the ant, and the ant is scaring people, so they fall into the water, and they would go once again. They continue to go until either they screw up the story or until they flip over a memory monster. If you flip over a memory monster, the game is over. And that is how the rules, which I don't recommend playing the game like that, are played. Alrighty then, the Memory Palace from Peaceable Kingdom. What are my final thoughts? Let's go over the pros. Let's go over the cons. First, on the con side, this is a children's game. Obviously, there's really not going to be any other situation where we're going to be playing this aside from as a family or with kids. That's just period. Also, I feel like it was a missed opportunity not to have double-sided tiles on the places. I feel like that would add a lot of extra variability to the game. I imagine it's for artwork constraints because the artwork is really nicely done in this game, but I would have liked to have seen that. I think that really would have been cool, and I think the kids would have liked it a lot as well. Any other cons I have with the game? Let's get to the big one, which is I think the rule booklet is bad. Bad, bad, naughty, get out of here rule booklet. And I don't mean in the sense that I normally mean, where it's difficult to understand and figure out the game. No, it's actually quite simple to figure out the game, but it's just not the optimal way to play the game, in my personal opinion. I really hated how the game was played. I played it the first time the way they wrote the rules, and I was like, no, no, this is bad. No, don't play like this. And I definitely So I'll tell you how we like to play it in my classroom and with my kids and my son. And what we did was, same thing, we set out the 4x4 grid, and then you take turns placing out the different animal tiles. You don't actually place the memory monsters out there. And then what you have to do is remember what the animal was doing in the said location. If you forget, then you have to flip over a memory tile. Why I like this version better, you know, because I'm criticizing the game, essentially, is because it keeps everyone involved. The whole concept of the memory master, I hate that concept. Why would you have this whole game where the children are actively involved? They have to be listening, at least in my version of the game. They're actively involved in the game. And by having a memory master, the children are no longer actively involved in the game. With the version that I did, it has the kids still going in a circle, and they have to remember different locations, and I normally make it so it's not one of their locations. This forces children to actively listen to everyone else at the group, which is a skill that is, I can't think of, needed in any other children's game. Now, let's get over to the pros, because I'm sounding like I'm slamming this game right now. No. You want a quote? I'll give you a quote right now. As a preschool teacher, I can say this wholeheartedly, this game should be in every preschool classroom in America. It is fantastic for what it does. It works on speech development so well. Because you'll get started and the kids will be like, the shark's swimming in the pool. And then I'll be like, oh, come on, what's he doing in the pool? What's he waiting for? It works on speech development with children, which is a fantastic skill to work on. We have so many kids who have so many speech problems just because they're not talking enough. And this does that. It gets children laughing and thinking creatively about different things the animals could be doing. And the artwork in the game really just pops that out. Like, they'll look at the picture and be like, oh, I noticed there's a teeny tiny little hole here, so this would be a good spot. The mouse just came out of the teeny tiny hole in the attic, and he's going to be making friends with the spider. And it really works on those skills, which is incredible. But most importantly, at least in the version that I play, not the version in this game, it forces children to listen. When I'm telling children the rules of the game, I say the number one rule is you have to listen to every single person that speaks, because you might be the person who has to remember that story. So children are actively engaged in each story because they know they have to listen. Because if they don't listen, they'll flip over the memory monster, and that's how we lose the game. And that's not even in this game. Only one person needs to be actively involved in listening in the stories, and I feel like that is a huge problem with the game. But if you play the game as the way that I would recommend playing the game, I think it is an amazing, amazing game. Like, it just frustrates me that some people are going to get this game and play it the way the rules state and be like, eh, it's okay. And that's a shame, because this game is outstanding. Every one of my co-teachers that I've showed this to has been like, whoa, I need to get this game. A game that forces children to listen but doesn't force them to listen is outstanding. It works on speech development. It has great artwork, great components. Just overall, the Memory Palace, if you have kids age, and it says ages 5+, ignore that. I was playing this with 3-year-olds, and they love the game. They love telling the stories. They love putting down the different pieces. And so I would say ages 3 to 7 or 8, absolutely, the Memory Palace is a fantastic game to check out, as long as you tweak the rules. Memory Palace, Peaceable Kingdom, outstanding. This is going to be one of those games that is always going to be in my classroom. Works on speech development, works on so much that a lot of other games don't do. Memory Palace from Peaceable Kingdom, if you modify the rules, absolutely amazing. If you don't modify the rules, it's okay. But if you enjoyed this review, please be sure to click on that subscribe button down below and in the comments below. Let me know if you had a palace. What would be the one interesting room in your palace that people are like, oh, really? You have a room that's just for that? For me personally, I think I would have a room that is just a buffet, a 24 hour buffet. And I'm making a really cheap buffet too. So it's actually going to be like attached to the side of my palace, like a completely different location. So there will always be people in there, you know, who I could talk to and chit chat with. I'm going to have it like be in a circle. It's not going to be like your typical restaurant where there's tables. No, it's going to be like one where it encourages everybody to talk to each other, like a bar type buffet setting. That's what I want a bar slash buffet at my palace. That's what I'd have. What would you have though? And let me know in the comments below. And as always, thanks for your time, YouTube.